5 of KPI at the rate of 85. And I invite Dr. Suresh Velangapudi to carry forward the discussion today. He's also the press speaker. And yes, Suresh, over to you.
I thought you were going to ask me to say something. Wait.
Yeah, Suresh will say. Okay, fine. Suresh was supposed to say, yeah.
Professor Dr. Parekh.
Yeah.
Dr. Kirit Parekh, you are about to say something, right?
Yeah. Please. You know, I wanted to just pay homage to one of my colleague and pioneer in input-output tables and particularly social accounting metrics in India, Dr. M.R. Saluja, who passed away only last week. I had known him since 1967 when I joined the Indian Statistical Institute. He had been working there even earlier. He had helped develop the first input-output table, which was used by Alan Mann in doing some runs for the Planning Commission for alternative thing, and along with Ashok Rudra. Some of you might not even know these names, but these were really some of the leading economists in those days. And Saluja was really a wonderful man. He was quiet, but he always worked quietly and meticulously on developing input-output tables and social accounting metrics. And almost anything on social accounting metrics that you see empirical work in India, you would see that it is his signature would be there somewhere or other, his contribution. So I think he was a month or two older than I am, and he passed away after his 85th birthday. And I think we can hold a minute silence in his honor, because we all are really have an ISI connection in some sense, and he was a dear friend. Okay, Suresh, you can continue now.
I start from where Professor Dr. Parekh said. I was a student at Indian Statistical Institute. I was taught by Professor Saluja official statistics, Rajvansh Talwar, and we learned that from him, and we could sense in him that approach, the meticulousness of it. And we all feel very bad about his passing away so soon, because he has been active. I saw his 2014 paper, which is a SAM for Andhra Pradesh, the state that is supposed to be the first SAM for any state of India. We need to learn. They left us legacy, and Ashok Rudra too. I didn't even know Ashok Rudra passed away until Guru Tirukkodi Kaval Srinivasan told me in 2004. So it's all sad things, but we all learned something from them. And Guru Kiritam pointed out, those were the exciting days where people did very good work. I suppose that continued to much later. Anyway, coming back to today's session to celebrate Guru Kiritam's 85th birthday, which we celebrated on August 1st, These are the continuing sessions. I am fortunate to have two additional speakers today. Dr. Samar Singh, who is my mathematical optimization conscience keeping activist. Okay. And Mr. T.R. Shankar, who is my mecha, that is my managerial economics conscience keeping activist. These two are very close friends. Dr. Singh and I were co-workers in BHEL Corporate Planning. And Shankar and I actually studied together for 5 years in IIT Madras. And we kept in touch afterwards too. And we are still in touch. So my mocha, that rhymes with moksha. Mathematical optimization conscience keeping activist Dr. Singh takes over now for the next half an hour, and there will be a 10-minute discussion after that. On to Dr. Singh.
Thank you. So first let me just say hello to everyone. I hope I can now get this thing working properly. I just wanted to say before I start that actually I'm a mathematician who wandered into optimization models of various kinds and then became a computer scientist. So what I'm presenting is, and I'm retired now, so it's something I've just been hobbying with. It's hobbying, dabbling. So it's nothing earth shaking, but I hope it will be of some interest to everyone. So I'll start that now. And now, this is about the sectoral balances, financial identity. And it's a mathematical exploration and exposition. And what I'm going to present is essentially for the Festschrift on the 85th birthday of Professor Parikh. My connection with Professor Parikh is somewhat indirect. I was on the lower floor of Yojana Bhavan when he was on the top floor. That is when the ISI Delhi unit was located on the top floor of the Yojana Bhavan. I was just a consultant and...
Hierarchically in Yojana Bhavan, the top floor was the lowest rung of the ladder.
Well, we were on the bottom floor. So I don't know which was lower, but anyway, we were both card-carrying members of the fraternity of computing users, along with friends Suresh Babu and Rajbans Talwar, and that is how I sort of moved in these circles. And when I say we are card-carrying members, then we used to actually carry those boxes of cards. So that is my connection. And what I'm going to talk about is about this sectoral balances or the sectoral balance financial identity. So now, what is this sectoral balances financial identity? And why do we want to?
You can share your screen now. Share the screen now.
You need to share the screen.
Oh, aren't you seeing the screen?
No.
Oh, I see. I'm sorry. So I should then go into share screen.
Yeah.
Share it. And again, open this.
Fine.
I think that's got it now. Okay. So the sectoral balance is financial identity. And I'll go on to the next. The festschrift on the 85th birthday of Professor Parikh. And I've said all this stuff. I was on the lower floor and we were card-carrying members. So what is this financial identity? It's something quite simple in macroeconomics. I'm not an economist, but I can see that it's something fairly simple. But at the same time, it's peculiar. It doesn't get mentioned much. For example, if you look in a textbook on macroeconomics, for example, by Mankiw, it's not there. He will talk about other things, national accounts and so forth, but he won't talk about this particular identity. And mostly these things get mentioned in blogs and in textbooks by people of the MMT School of Economics. So for example, the textbook by Mitchell, Ray and Watts contains a description of this identity. Wikipedia has a page on it, and I will stick with that as my basic reference, and all the other references are there. Okay, so in Wikipedia, the way they prove it, or say they derive, I should say, this identity, is you start with the ways in which you measure GDP in the economy, and we talk of all the expenditure that can occur, say in 1 year, that is the GDP. And that is this typical formula which says that it's the the total is the consumption plus the investment plus government expenditure plus the exports minus the imports. So that is one way of looking at the GDP. It's simple. You can add a few other terms and so on, but I'll keep it very simple. We can also consider the way the private sector treats this entire income. So we look at how they actually get to spend it. And that is the same thing, which is consumption and taxes, and then the saving. So what's left over is the saving. So now you can equate these two, where you can say these are identical. And you can eliminate the C, and you get S plus T on this side, and I plus G plus X minus M on the other side. And then you can bring everything to one side. And this is how you get it. Now, because we said these two are identical, we say this is identically equal to zero. The first term can be looked at as the deficit of the private sector. So you're saying this is the investment they do minus the savings. And what we are saying then is that this is the excess of the investment over the savings. So it's the deficit. Similarly, the second term is the total government expenditure less the taxes. Now, this essentially, if the government expenditure is more than tax, then you have a deficit. So this is the sort of budget deficit. And the last term, of course, is the exports minus the imports. So this tells us what is our foreign exchange, you could say, deficit. or the current account deficit. So these are three deficits, and you are saying these are all, you add them up and you should get identically zero. Okay, so that's all right. What is the interpretation? And that is that the private sector deficit plus the government deficit plus the external deficit should identically equal zero. Okay, this interpretation is important because I think many people don't seem to like it. And the reason for it, I think, is largely got to do with politics. It says, if there is no surplus from the external sector, so if you don't have, a huge trade surplus, then a government surplus can only occur with increasing private sector debt. Now, this is the problem, because when people want to pay down the government debt, they say you should have a surplus budget. But what this identity is telling you is that the surplus budget will occur with increasing private sector debt unless you have a huge, let's say, trade surplus. And you can see what people think of this. This is a tweet from Anne Pettifor. I think everybody probably has heard of her, but she was one of the advisors to Jeremy Corbyn when he was leader of the Labour Party in the UK. And she's telling us here that this sectoral balances thing, it belongs to accounting, it's not economics, and she's not comfortable with it. So I don't know what it means that she's not comfortable with it, but anyway. So there's a problem of getting people to accept this identity. That tweet was from October 29, 2015.
Super hit blockbuster film.
Sirf 1 rupee. Please care
the page. Have I? Okay. So people can say this is arbitrary because the way you have put these things together, you have not captured the complexity of the economy. It's very simple. And maybe those two things are not identical, you know, the way we looked at the expenditure and we looked at how the private sector will spend their money and so on. So we can question the interpretation of this entire identity, the way it was derived using national accounting quantities. And it depends on the way you have defined investment and you have defined savings and so on. So there are people who have said, I don't agree with this. In fact, this I don't agree statement was made by an important politician who later on became one of the treasurers in Australia. So this is the person who this is a person who probably should know something about budget deficits and things like this. And he just said he doesn't accept this identity at all. So I thought, let's look at this and in a little more rigorous way and see whether we can remove the, shall we say, the politically sensitive quantities which are being used here and look at it purely in a mathematical way. And the way I thought I could do this was with something like a accounting matrix. Now, this is not exactly social accounting matrix. It's a cut-down version. In the sense, it's simply accounting. So we make it completely abstract, and we say, well, look, we have three entities, A, B, and C, and they are making payments to each other. And what we do is we put them here again on this side and here on top. And then we say if P is the payment which B has made to A, then we put it into the cell. So we are reading downwards from A. We are saying these are the items which A is paying out. So of course it pays itself zero. It pays a quantity R to B, and it pays a quantity T to C. And similarly, B pays to A, and it pays to C, and so on. So these are completely abstract quantities. And we can see now that the row sum, this is the total amount that A will receive from the others. And the column sum is the total amount that A, for example, will pay out to the others. So we can see that if you take the column sum, which is the payout, and the row sum, which is the amount you earn, then the first sum minus the second sum is your deficit. So this is purely abstract, and we can put it in these terms. The rows show the payments made to an entity from other entities. Row sum is the total income of that entity. The columns show what payments are going out from an entity to other entities. And the important thing is that we have not tried to balance this in any way. It's not required to be balanced. In fact, we expect there would be some imbalance. So the column sum is the expenditure. And for any entity, it follows that the column sum minus the row sum is equal to the deficit. Okay, so we've got three deficits for the three entities. And if we sum them all up, then deficit of A plus deficit of B plus deficit of C should be, of course, the column sum of A, column sum of B, plus column sum of C, minus the row sum of all the three. So I've taken this column sum A minus row sum A was the deficit of A, and so on. So I've just added them up separately. Okay, now we can see that if you add all the column sums, or if you add all the row sums, you will get nothing but the sum of all the items in the matrix. So column sums together equal all row sums together. And each of them is nothing more than the sum of the elements in the table. And therefore, we can state our little lemma, which is that the three deficits must be identically equal to zero. It doesn't matter what the values of those P, Q, R, S, T are, you must get these three deficits equal to zero. And that's an identity. This is always true by definition. And if you take the matrix and put in those same quantities that we had from the national accounting, then you will see that, for example, the private sector pays taxes T to the government. It pays money for imports. And the government receives taxes from the private sector. And the private sector receives payment from the government and receives money for its exports and so on. So if you repeat that whole thing of taking the row sums and the column sums and subtracting one from the other, what you will get is this. And this is, of course, identically equal to zero because everything cancels. What we did in the previous derivation was we replaced this middle term with I minus S. And you can do that. It's just the deficit of the private sector. And we can rewrite it as I minus S from our previous logic, or we can express it any other way. But it doesn't matter because the sum of all these three deficits must be equal to zero. Okay, so the two proofs are slightly different because in the first one, we had some algebra and then interpreted the result to imply the three deficits sum to zero. In the second case, we proved that the three deficits must add identically to zero. And then we put our interpretation of the private sector deficit. So no matter what we think of as the private sector deficit, the three deficits must sum to zero. And here is an example with data from the Australian economy, where the domestic savings are here in brown. The foreign savings, that is the savings of the foreign sector, are there in yellow. And the gray is the government deficit. Now, Australia had a period here where the government had surplus budgets. And you can see the result of that because there was no trade surplus. The private sector deficit or the surplus went negative and we had large deficits. So the private sector's deficit, which means the accumulated deficit, which is the debt, went from something like 50% of GDP to about 150% of GDP. So these things actually do happen. Although I have had people who write on economic matters as journalists, and they wanted to actually test whether this data can be plugged into the identity to see if the identity is true. Now, as a mathematician, I was, of course, horrified because an identity is true by definition. But anyway, journalists will be journalists. Okay, so I think the conceptual difference in the proofs probably explain the difficulty of convincing people of the validity of this identity. However, some people even now are not satisfied if you show them this accounting matrix and say this must prove this identity. And so they say, well, you see, because the difficulty of balancing the SAMs, the actual social accounting matrices, there is some problem in this data. And if we aggregate all these expenditures in this fashion, how do we know that this whole result is not an artifact of aggregation? So each sector consists of thousands of entities interacting with thousands of others. So we can start with a different model, which you just start with a set S of many thousands of elements, finite in number, each making payments to every other. And we assume that there is a payment Pij, which goes from I to J.
You have about 7 minutes more.
Yeah, just quickly. So if A and B are subsets of S, we can define a deficit of A with respect to B. I write it as D A bar B because it's slightly looks a bit like probabilities. But anyway, it's simply the sum of all payments made from I to J with all I's in A and all J's in B. And you subtract away the payments made from B to A. Okay, this is a sort of pictorial idea of that. And this is well defined. We just stress the order of the arguments of this function. And now we define some simple properties. So the function A with respect to A is identically zero, which is obvious because you're subtracting payments made from A to payments made to A. And we define for the empty set, that is just putting things, tidying them up. And the partition lemma simply says if A1 and A2 are partition of A, that means A1 and A2 are disjoint, and A1 union A2 is equal to A, then the deficit of A with respect to B is the deficit of A1 with respect to B plus deficit of A2 with respect to B. And the proof of that is simply that you can split those summations in the formula according to the fact that this is a partition. And corollary is it works the other way around also. So if A1 and A2 is a partition of A, then the deficit of B with respect to A can be split in the same way. And we can extend this to a partition of three, a size three. So we finally get our main theorem, which we say that the deficit of A1 with respect to the complement of A1 plus the deficit of A2 with respect to complement of A2 and the deficit of A3 with respect to the complement of A3 is identically equal to zero. And to prove it is very simple. We know that the deficit of any set with respect to itself is identically zero. And we now split S into its partitions. And then we can split the S on the other side into the partition. And we straight away get our theorem. We could have proved this, of course, by brute force also using the summation and substituting the definition in the terms. So I've now given several ways of proving this identity, which do not depend on the particular national accounting. It's simply the algebra of accounting. And there's no requirement for GDP or other aspects of national accounts, but we can use this identity in that context. And the identity is true no matter how we partition the set. So it's much more general than we would have thought. Okay. Okay, so the implication for national accounts is proven beyond doubt. Government surpluses imply private sector deficit or debt if there is no foreign income surplus. And for international trade, every country cannot have a trade or current account surplus. Somebody must have a deficit to compensate for the surplus. And all surpluses and deficits must sum to zero. Well, that's all I have to say for the moment. Thank you for your attention. And if you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer them.
Well, let me make a couple of observations. I think this is just another way of looking at the national account's identity. Mm-hmm. And if you are looking at the data of Australia, for example, and saying that all the balance, most likely the international surplus or deficit foreign was calculated as a residual by economies, so that by definition they would match. But it's true that this is certainly true, that no matter how you partition this, this is going to be true. And this is a good way of looking at it, so that those who say that I don't like this accounting identity and it's not economics, maybe they should feel a little more comfortable with this, because this is nothing that they can escape.
Well, that was basically the idea behind my little investigation. And I'm glad you think that it's a little more solid proof. Is there any other question? Well, if
I don't have a question, but I think that apart from Australia's data, if we can also present data of multiple countries, trading countries, major countries, and show simultaneously that, you know, these three identities operating at various levels, I think that would make a very good impact for the policymakers and naysayers. That, you know, this has to be the case. So we can make cases for, say, different countries who have, maybe have not had government surpluses, but have had trade surpluses, and therefore so different strategies working in different countries. But potentially this is the three things. So that way probably would make a very good, solid evidence for policymakers across, because that's like inter-country comparison. I think that is one comment I have.
Thank you. Thank you. In fact, I could probably show Norway, which always has a huge trade surplus because of its North Sea oil. And they have surplus budgets year after year after year, but it doesn't cause any problem.
I think so. And interesting would be the grouping countries, you know, of different types, and the way they're structured would be a very good way to present this small and yet a very interesting policy feature.
Thank you for that.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Singh. We'll go on to the next speaker, Mr. T.R. Shankar. He retired as head of the department of management and IFAC business school. He has very interesting things to say about our information technology sector. When I say our, I mean India's information technology sector. He has been, as I joke about him, he led an American life in India, working completely in private sector after his MBA from IIM Calcutta, and working on his own for some time, and then actually teaching and retiring as head of the Department of Management. Now on to Shankar. Hey, Shankar, you have to unmute your thing. Yeah.
Good evening to all of you.
Yeah.
In fact, let me first thank Dr. Kirit Parekh for giving me the opportunity, and also Dr. Jyoti Parekh to make a presentation. Let me once again congratulate Dr. Kirit Parekh for his 85th birthday celebration, and we are still continuing with that. And today's presentation, I wanted to talk about Indian IT industry as well as what is in due for our nation, Digital India. And the first 5 minutes, I will just quickly what exactly happened in the last 4 or 5 decades, and which also coincides with my life and career. In fact, first time, the beginning, 1950s, LIC computerization was being talked about, and there was a lot of union resistance, things like that. Then came the 60s, there was a time, people of my generation entered college. IIT Madras was a very large campus, but we did not have a single computer. We were waiting for the country's largest computer, IBM 370, and which came after I left the institute. And same, when I did my MBA at Calcutta also, we had one computing accounting machine, which is strictly electromechanical, not electronic digital computer. And there was no programming and all. We had to do control panel wiring to solve some simple problems. All that we did was solving quadratic equations, things like that. And then 73, I started my career. First company was Best in Crompton. It had IBM 1401, which was considered as a second generation computer based on this transistor technology, the stage before integrated circuits entered the scene. Then 1975 emergency, 77 change of government, Janata government came into power. And then we had George Fernandez, who was industries minister. And he said, we do not need IBM and Coca-Cola for our country. And in fact, because IBM, for instance, he felt they are actually leasing fully depreciated computers and also older technology. And then they have been asked to leave the country. But that decision also simultaneously, more or less, gave birth to microcomputer industry. And I was also reading about microprocessor chips, computer on a chip development, and got an offer from HCL, which was one of the earliest microcomputer companies, even though those days it was more of kit assembling. And there were only, in fact, you'll be surprised to know at that time, there were only 4 computer companies, microcomputer companies in the country. Then 80s, 85, you can say roughly, internet arrived in India. And 91 economic liberalization. And of course, 86, 84, the computer policy was announced in India for the first time. Then after economic liberalization had started, 95, we'll remember Windows 95. And also generally people were feeling that COBOL programs written in 60s, which did not take into account turning over of the millennium, all programs will fail, aircrafts will fall down and all that. But on the other side of that, what was looked upon as a big problem for them turned out to be a golden opportunity for a country like India, because we were able to send a lot of COBOL programmers to US, because in those days, no physical presence was required, unlike these days. And then, of course, recent past, I will cite 2002, mobile phones had started as a major device. And 2010, we can say slowly, the 4G, we were shifting from 2G to 3G to 4G. 2016, is Reliance announced data network, and they said voice calls free. That actually was one of the important moments where more and more people started using it, and IT was no more meant only for the elite groups, but also meant for the common man, in terms of whether he is from a small town or whether he is from a, what do you call it, even a rural village. Everyone had that kind of access. Now I will start my presentation on the Digital India. Let me see, I'll just share screen. So sharing option has been enabled.
Yeah, you are already you're sharing your screen. You have to open the PPT on your desktop.
Okay. You're able to see the screen?
Yep.
Okay. So basically this is about a lot of changes or the transformation. When I say transformation, it is something like the life cycle of a butterfly. We talk about metamorphosis. So it's a larva to pupa to finally a beautiful butterfly, even though nobody would have recognized it when it was in the earlier stages. Same thing is happening for many of the businesses, industries, and also the, the way the government is going to govern the nation. And ultimately, it has got very wide influence on the entire members of the society. So a lot of changes have been taking place. And currently, excuse me for starting with pandemic, but pandemic has been a very major event, which has disrupted a lot of things, but also I believe it has thrown up a lot of new opportunities. So in the recent KPMG report, it clearly says that disrupted pandemic has disrupted traditional patterns, and also how people interact and behave when it comes to economic activities, like let us say shopping or paying money, things like transferring funds from one account to another account, which obviously leads to a lot of changes, structural changes, and it affects everything, the way we live, the way we are going to work, and where we are going to play. And so when we change the way of working, the new models, also if you take the working from home, it has got huge implications for urban planning, because we cannot continue to build cities the way we used to do earlier, where people had to go to office and go to factory, things like that. And it will also have a good impact on the environment, and also hopefully decongestion of traffic. And this kind of major changes are always possible. And of course, companies continue to do that. And another important aspect is, whenever we talk about product today, it is not just the functional product, but it has got software and data, artificial intelligence, all these technologies embedded into that, which can lead to more number of options and also better customer engagement. And this kind of technology-led market, of course, the valuations have been going up. I think in another report from McKinsey, there is a huge potential for unlocking economic value if we deploy the technologies properly. In fact, Dr. Kirit Parekh paper I was just going through, forwarded by Suresh Babu, it talks about building technological capabilities and self-reliance. And there he also raises a concept of what is it, know-how. Know which. Telling is we should be right technology on the give a maximum impact. And so know which becomes very important. And which is required. Dr. Parekh is a combination of engineers and engineers with.
I think people should unmute their speak, you know, unmute themselves so that there is no additional sound coming in. Because Professor Shankar's sound is not coming clearly.
Oh, I'll just let me come closer. Now you are able to hear me? So this McKinsey report has talked about the huge potential, which can be an opportunity for us. And the traditional concepts are getting obsolete, like too much importance to the location of work, like going to office and things like that. And because work can be done anywhere from wherever the worker is. And also 9 to 5 need not be always 9 to 5, fixed working hours. And high touch governance for doing shopping, you used to go to the shop and then look at the product and then feel it and then take decision. That need not be the case all the time. And also when it comes to management or supervision, it's not that your subordinate or your team member has to be always within your line of sight. The presenteeism as a prerequisite for better results or optimal productivity need not be the case. And many of the number crunching or information handling jobs, which are considered as a cushy middle level jobs, they are obviously disappearing. And so whenever we talk about digital, because right from Prime Minister, everyone is talking about digital India. What exactly does it signify? What exactly it means to us? Few points are infinitely scalable. And that means it does not matter whether you are handling for 100 cases or 10,000 cases. In fact, the next para you can see there, the information can be very easily communicated, replicated, and transmitted at virtual zero marginal cost. So that means to a near infinite number of recipients, even the number of people, your number of people need not be limited. And they can be anywhere in the world, location independency. And the third point is even more valuable, also connected again at zero marginal cost to other complementary activities. Supposing, let us take airline. Airlines, they have got a complete schedule and seats availability and all that information that has to be provided to the customer. And now the travel agents come into picture. The travel agent systems can be again linked to the airline system. And this is also in a very dynamic way. Any update in the schedule will be automatically made available too. So like this, you keep on expanding the network effect or whatever you might call. That will keep adding even more and more value to itself. So that is why, in fact, the important points here are scalability and transmission at fastest speed, zero marginal cost to the extra number of recipients, and also zero marginal cost to the other complementary activities. So this kind of facility, what it does is digital transformation, where there are three major elements. You would have, of course, many of you would have already become familiar with that, cloud migration. So if you are doing processing of jobs, you don't have to keep the server at your location. And also it means one is a lot of technical work, and if anything fails, you do not know how to do it. There are experts to handle it. And the cloud automatically enables the scalability also. In fact, first time I remember, in Tamil Nadu state government, they announced this 10th standard exam, public exam results will be available on internet and through their government data center. And obviously they had their own data center. But you are talking about 10 lakh students, and supposing you say 10 o'clock in the morning, the results will be announced. All that they are going to know is pass or fail. And all the 10 lakh students will immediately, log in. And in fact, before when they announced itself, I was just worrying how, because after 5 minutes, nobody is interested in that information. Because once they know that, they have passed or failed, that is over. So if the same thing has been handled by a cloud company, they are always ready in terms of capacity as well as technical capability to do the upscaling and downscaling in a very, very easy way. The second concept is software as a service. And because earlier you would have heard about this software product licensing, Microsoft Windows and Microsoft Office, these are all very famous. And whereas here, now somebody else is again doing it for you. It may be this kind of SAP platform or some other platform. And there are companies even in India, like Zoho and Freshworks, they have taken up this route, and there are about 3 or 4 unicorns and also a lot of startups getting into this. And the success stories of this new crop of service providers is going to definitely open up more and more opportunities. And third component is your product, software product. Just as an example, I mentioned about core banking software or Infosys, Pinnacle, or TCS banks. So any of these things will always have advantage. In fact, even Prime Minister was talking about we must do more of this product development and also export it to provide service to international clients. So the multiple forces at work in the recent past. And so all these things are happening. TCS CEO put it very nicely. We are amidst a multi-year transition wave. And simultaneously, COVID crisis is also going on. And at the same time, because of COVID, people are not hesitant to shift to digital mode. And economy has shrunk. Of course, that is the problem for most of the countries. And job losses, migrant workers have suffered. So many people have lost jobs. And India-China border tensions and global trade tensions, splitting supply chains. Splitting supply chains is also, it worked to some extent in our favor. Yesterday only PM was talking about 9 Apple production units have shifted to India. And of course, UCI, you are aware, volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity. And even though we are using a lot of apps but there is a lot of complexity behind it. In fact, in one of the recent surveys, 50% of the developers feel the volume of code has increased almost 100 times compared to what it was 10 years back. So whereas as an ordinary user, we may not realize it, but that is the kind of complexity of many of these digital solutions. And of course, COVID has, it's not that we are not adapting to digital environment. They were doing it slowly, but COVID has come, and because of lockdown and the physical movement restrictions, it has automatically accelerated the digital adoption. And startups also helped consumers shop, pay for bills, converse, entertain, and collaborate. So you can see so many of these fundamental tasks, they have come to help. And this kind of adoption itself can be a positive thing for the internet industry. And so when we talk about strategy, obviously now you can see it is all pervasive. It covers citizens, society, organizations, industry, way the government works and governs the nation, and also work practices and management. So I mean, practically every aspect around us, that is the kind, when what I mean is when we are designing solutions, we have to have all these factors in mind. And IT, the components are the infrastructure part. And in fact, the fiber cable network has to be laid for more and more communication. It has to even go reach remote areas. And UPI platform, which is one of the successes. Apparently, they have crossed 2 billion transactions so far. And daily volume is almost around 42 million, which is supposed to be the highest in the world. So that means our people, particularly even from people from small town, they have adopted to these digital payments also. Then the connectivity, the 4G adoption has been increasing, 5G is waiting. And these three technologies I already talked about. Then devices, mobile apps, there are even mega aggregators. In fact, Tata for their consumer products is thinking of having a common aggregator for the entire thing and aggregator app. And other issues, of course, security, privacy is also important. And there are certain dark aspects about artificial intelligence, which we have to have in mind. And of course, the behavior of big tech, because sometimes they can become a monopoly power, and also social media problems, which spreads fake news and hate speech. And also the good side of it is if our country is able to develop more and more open source software, instead of just always relying on proprietary code, that can also be a plus point. And one second. Sorry. So I decided to use one of the techniques commonly used in management, strength SWOT analysis, strength, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. And basically it is a logical analytical framework, which is usually helps discussion about what is happening, and also how the what kind of choices we can make. But of course, at the same time, you must remember it is an only one time snapshot, because it's always a change, is always a dynamic. Opportunities, there are plenty of opportunities, few of them I will just quickly go through. In fact, there was one UN report, he calls it as, we can nudge digital, current digital trajectory in good ways, positive ways, also trying to minimize the downside risks. And basically he's talking about financial inclusion. More and more, like, you know, people are able to get small loans very quickly and without even collateral. And ultimately it is the people's money which is has to be circulated. And then of course, technology is always there at the heart of new business models. And there is also, because of COVID, the technology spend has been increasing. It is almost 7%, whereas the traditional functions like, you know, marketing, manufacturing, they all gone into the negative percentage. So that means corporates realize the value of digital technology, and they are willing to put more money. And the e-tail market is growing. And there also, there are direct-to-channel brands, where is the concept of disintermediation is also happening. And India has been the number one choice for foreign direct investment in the recent past, the last few months. And of course, pandemic speeding up automation and forcing companies to invest in cloud. And in fact, this was actually given, explained very well by TCS CEO. And there are a lot of R&D tech centers and hubs, a lot in Bangalore and other cities in India. And vaccine delivery project itself will test our abilities, which will be, which can, because it has got inbuilt digital infrastructure, which is required for inventory management and last mile delivery. And this trend is likely to continue. We will be working remotely even 10 years from now. And in fact, Ericsson report calls it as dematerializing. And ultimately, the algorithms and networks can run the operations. And of course, if it is not handled properly, it can also create problems. And data and artificial intelligence can add $500 billion to the economy in 5 years. And open source, of course, I already mentioned. Software products, there is a tremendous potential because that is growing at a much higher rate. And supply chain changes, we have good reason to believe in terms of opportunities to make good use of that. The work has started. And also there is an increasing trend for low skilled workers, like the delivery people, warehouse workers, and whether we like it or not, we have to adopt this change. And of course, there are certain social welfare benefits which have to be taken care of, that I will be talking subsequently. And another important thing is farmers as a segment, they also should get the benefit out of technology because of disintermediation and even corporate involvement. In fact, ITC, eChowpal has been going on for the past 20 years, and where we are in a position to empower the farmers, give them freedom of choice as to whom they have to sell and at what price. And of course, threats are there. China is also trying to link up with all the Asian neighbors, not only physical BRI, but also the digital level and 5G technology, they are ahead. And earlier we were talking about software exports, US market, and sending people over there, that is going to be a problem. Because there are a lot of visa hurdles. And employee burnout. The one side is okay, working from home and productivity has improved and saving in commutation. But many of the people that the surveys conducted, 50% of the people feel that the work span time in a day has increased at least by 1 hour. And also they are not very comfortable with the blurring distinction between work and living. Work and life. So we have to ensure, because we cannot afford to kill human assets. And let us hope that corporates do not become over greedy in terms of exploiting the employee time, and which will lead to unnecessary stress and anxiety. And of course, there are also people without accountability, with the power of influencers and increased reach, they have got, so that sometimes has got negative consequences. And of course, attacks, cyber attacks. In fact, even as soon as some trials had started, we saw the Dr. Reddy Laboratories site was hacked. But of course, it was only their own data center. They got it up within, I think, 1 day. And strengths are, of course, people have the aptitude and talent. And there's also a startup ecosystem is quite active, and they want to deliver a lot of innovative solutions, and data usage has increased. And of course, new practices, particularly digital technology has been applied in a very big way, in particularly education and health, which obviously touches more number of people in the society. And the digital infrastructure has been built up. We also have some experience in terms of immunization programs in the past, that even though that was meant for children and pregnant mothers and 5 doses, whereas now vaccine thing will be 2 doses, but more number of people. Even in the first phase, I understand 30 crore people are to be covered. And already we have direct benefit transfer infrastructure. In terms of transfers and also key for small loans to poor. All these things have to be leveraged, that I told you about that zero marginal cost. That principle has to be applied. And near real-time payments, in fact, I already mentioned about this, and it has jumped, doubled recently. And the real-time gross settlement system, RBI has recently announced it will be available from 24/7 from December, which means better integration of our financial markets with the globe, rest of the globe. And I briefly mentioned about SaaS success, and apps invariably help in better engagement with the customer. And if FDI is coming, we have to make the things easy for them. So single window clearance, and in fact, central government is hoping that 20 states will be on board. Particularly, the first step is invariably land, making land available for, let us say, factories, setting up new factories. And then we have even the MNCs, which are operating in India, they have 2/3 of MNCs. They have India is the number one choice. And 34% of the investment is coming to India, at least the current year. And even US is able to attract only 19%, China is 10%. So that is again a positive thing from India's point of view. And festival season sales, we have been quickly adapting. And signing of IT deals is also picking up, which means we will be able to develop and hone our skills for training the next generation of youngsters. And devices, 50 million phones just in one quarter, and that too through online channel. And most of the sales happened for rural towns, rural villages and small towns. And there are some good examples like blockchain, where Tamil Nadu government has been open about e-governance. Simple thing like people, when they lose their qualification certificate or even the caste certificate, which is very important. So the authentication is very, very simple because of blockchain technology. So they are going ahead with that. And also the other advantage is any of the state government projects, multiple departments have to coordinate. So blockchain technology helps in a very big way in terms of the coordination. And when it comes to BPM, Business Process Management Centers, even the remote areas are getting the attraction, because you can get the job done even in smaller places, employ local talent, because the skill requirement is not very high. And of course, in terms of political leadership, people generally seem to accept the PM's commitment, and they are also responding in terms of due election results, as you can see. So they have a lot of hopes, expectations from him. Weakness, of course, weak digital infrastructure in remote areas, even power supply can be a problem. And industry ready engineering graduates, because there should not be a disconnect between what industry needs and what is being actually taught in terms of educational institutions. Of course, national education policy is just starting, and hope they'll be able to move fast as much as possible. Automation intensity is still very low. In fact, to give some statistics, in South Korea, in a typical factory manufacturing setup, there are 850 robots per 10,000 workers. And the next level is Japan and Germany, only 300 plus. And China, US is some 200 plus. China is 170 or something like that. But China growth rate has been very high. They are trying to catch up. And which will, of course, eliminate some of the jobs. It will also create new jobs. And health data policy, there are privacy concerns, because ultimately it's personal data. And for that, we will require definitely a proper legal system to protect citizens' data in the form of privacy laws. And of course, app ban has been done, but that is not enough. And also, government, the Vodafone case, they are appealing again, want to appeal against the award, International Tribunal Award. and Auditor General has felt that this is not the right time, and because you are also simultaneously trying to attract foreign direct investment. So, and of course, jobs, if they don't come, youth will become very restive. And even the latest thing is even RCEP isolation can, because all said and done, China is one of the biggest, what do you call, trading partner, which we cannot totally neglect. So the basically the strategy is we have to choose some other areas, whatever is appropriate for us. Not that we have to become masters in every technology, the core technology.
Five more minutes.
Okay. Yeah, only two more slides. So bring rural India into mainstream, because that is democratization of the latest technology available, made available to more number of people. And labor reforms also, they started. There should not be too much of a distinction between permanent employee and the contract worker. And so they are also, I mean, as a human being, they are also eligible to get. We cannot, you know, hide behind certain rules and laws. And of course, it requires huge focus on generating jobs. And collaboration is another important thing between government and private, between central and state governments, academic and industry, and also wherever possible, if we can have good agreements with the nations, definitely that will be a positive thing to do. And increasing industry competitiveness. You can give protection for a short period, but ultimate goal should be to improve the global competitiveness. Only that can uplift the nation, increase the GDP, and uplift people from poverty levels. And of course, continuous learning and upskilling and reskilling, which is also required. And government support for the some of the, you know, technology-aided work practices to encourage them. And financial safety net, we already discussed. And employability of graduate students also. Things to avoid, which comes to my mind, governments should not overpromise and then less talking and more doing. And in fact, I just mentioned about health and education. The two ministers we have, they seem to be talking oriented, and they are also more serious about whatever they are trying to do. And excessive and overzealous regulation also can kill innovation. And employee burnout, which I already mentioned, which cannot be totally ignored. And of course, climate change and environmental decay has always been there. We also have seen when we had a lockdown, people could see Himalayas right from Punjab, things like that. Or even in a local river, you can see the river bottom because the water is clear. So environmental thing, whatever we do, that should not contribute to carbon emissions and things like that. So there are, on the whole, I feel that we are on a positive wicket. And of course, the strategy point, still I am thinking about it, is only a work in progress. And where I will also like to hear from the other participants of their ideas, how exactly we can improve the quality of life and simplify life for Indian citizens, irrespective of their religion or gender or sex or the place of origin, where they are living, where they are working, things like that. And if that happens, as Dr. Parikh had said, we should choose the right alternatives to go on the right path without too much of fighting among ourselves. So with that, I'll invite questions from the respected audience. Thank you.
Any questions?
Let me
yes, sir.
Make a couple of comments.
Yeah.
You know, I started programming in 1957 on a 704 computer at MIT, which occupied, I think, a room which was perhaps 1,000 square feet. And, and it had only memory of 32 kilobytes.
Oh.
And your program and and instructions and data, and everything had to reside in that.
Yes.
And your skills really involved in packing everything in a small way and operating data between tapes and your memory in a way that you do not really use too much of time. And that's how the system was. I used to run India's planning model, which had a linear programming one, which had 256 constraints and used to take an hour to solve. And then of course, 5 minutes for every subsequent variation. And I used to get 4 hours of computer time, because then there was no time sharing.
Yeah.
Almost in the middle of the night at 12 p.m. I used to work from 12 to 4 and sort my papers, everything, and go home. Before that, stopping on the midway at a truck stop to eat my breakfast and then go to bed. But I think we have come a long way in this. Today, you know, a small handheld mobile has more power than those computers had in those days. But it has also led to a variety of opportunities and problems, and you have described them beautifully. I think particularly the impact of COVID in the development and the way in which we will go, you've really done it well. Now, one question I had was that, how do we bridge the digital divide between the rural people? Now, you know, today we have made a lot of progress in education through computers or remote learning and remote health even. But a large number of students in rural areas do not have access to internet.
Yes.
And there is one telephone which the father, the mother, and the two children have to share, and this becomes very, very unfortunate. Now, I hope that we can find, you know, we could provide all children with a smartphone, and then I think things would be very, very different. But these are some of the things I think we need to worry about.
Yes.
But do you think remote working would work from home would be very dominant? Because there are some gains to be working, meeting people and working together and going to an office. Yes. Some interaction that takes place from on work from home does not really quite match up to the worth you get from face-to-face and frequent interactions with your colleagues.
Yeah, actually, one is it will vary from industry to industry. Supposing for IT industry, the TCS CEO had given one formula, 25%. He says 25% of the people, maximum 25% of the people will be working in office. And for maximum 25% of the time, even within project teams, not more than 25% of the members at a time will be in office. Of course, this percentage will vary because there are, supposing you're talking about delivery logistics companies, the physical activity is equally important. I mean, that is more important. So it will vary from the sector to sector. And ultimately, I believe that we have to choose the judicious combination of both remote working as well as in-place working. And that's what will happen.
Yeah.
And the other issue.
Yeah, I think if people are working at home, you say at least come 2 days a week or 3 days a week and meet, and you can work the rest of the time from home. That's required.
Yes.
For some of the things, even for research institutes, that may be important.
Yes.
If you are doing a project with a group, then that interaction becomes critical.
Yes, absolutely.
I have some comments to make.
Yeah.
The first thing that I would like to point out in your presentation is the point that the digital technologies and everything should be available at zero marginal cost. That's a very important point that is made, because usually when I go to the market and I pay a vendor to say credit card or a PTM or something, that reply comes from the vendor that, you know, that you may be charged 2% extra if you make a credit card payment. You can withdraw it from the ATM and pay me, or you can pay from the debit card, or, you know, that kind of thing. The seller itself is not ready to get into that kind of a transaction. So I think this thing that that government has, which they probably they're not thinking about, that they have 2% extra on a credit card payment or a Paytm payment, should be thought about if they are really serious about the Digital India policy. That is first point. The second things are more about the critical, things in your paper. See, one of the most important things that is a constraint for digitalization in India is the aspect of security. And you may know that, you know, the security part, a lot of online thefts have been happening, and it is mostly happening to people who are not so, not so well, you know, they're not very good at your online things. So there is one problem is that there's a lot of illiteracy in the country, and there's also something called digital illiteracy. The large part of people are not so, thorough about, handling online things, mobiles, internet banking, and etc. And this OTP, telling OTP and money getting lost is a very common thing. So that is one of the major constraints. Now the other thing, so your presentation doesn't talk about that constraint. So I would like you to shed more on that. Then the other thing, two things that I would like to say is that, now digitization is definitely good. I am completely into digitization because I use Paytm, I use credit cards, and it has made my life very easy. I pay online bills. To me, it's very intuitive that digitization is good and should increase the ease of doing work. But I have not seen any empirical analysis which shows that with increasing digitization, what has it contributed to the GDP, or what part of GDP, or how much quantification of digitization. That is something I have not seen at all. And that is something, if someone sheds light on that, that's a more persuasive argument in favor of digitization. Next point that I want to share is that the paper also should talk on what the government needs to invest in for for digitization. What I mean is that digitization has two more constraints. One is the quality of internet that is available in India, not just in rural areas, even in urban areas. Specifically during the time of demonetization, many vendors would complain that the internet is down, it's not working. So they're not able to take payments. It happened that time. Even now, many times it happens that, the net is very slow, it doesn't work. So that's a major constraint that affects digitization. So what is the quality of internet that is there in India vis-a-vis what is there abroad, and therefore what India should do to improve the quality of that internet services? That is something you need to talk about. And what is the investments, what kind of platforms India needs to invest on, create on, to increase the security, to increase the transparency of things? That is something that the paper doesn't talk of, and I would be very it would be very interesting if a persuasive paper for digitization if the paper talks on that. Yeah. So I think that's what few of the points that I want to make.
I agree with you. In fact, a very important point. And in fact, I mentioned that our digital infrastructure is still very weak. And the other side of it is, you had mentioned about the people, money theft and things like that. Government should make this more and more popular, and because nowadays multiple language options are available, so that people generally, I believe, Indian villager is fairly smart and fairly intelligent, and they are capable of learning. And in fact, two, three times I mentioned about the 4G adoption. Adoption in the last few years has been phenomenal. And in fact, there are a lot of, they call it as even for retail, VVV. This is voice, video, and vernaculars. So that kind of course, government cannot also do everything. There has to be a lot of initiatives from the private companies, which will help, which will also be in their interest in the long run. Because in fact, I think Dr. Parikh was talking about digital divide. And see, when people are not able to get the basic facilities, now people, when they say work from home, they can work from anywhere. So that means even the technical work, people can shift to the smaller towns. But along with that, if you think of some clusters, and if you are able to simultaneously develop additional facilities, like let us say schools, basic minimum hospitals, and other recreation activities as a whole, I mean, this kind of a holistic approach will help. That means more activities, more job, more money in their pockets, and they will be able to spend. And this reverse migration is good at both ends. The cities will get decongested. Everybody need not be in the city. And also you make the smaller towns more and more attractive. All that boils down to the government investing money in the infrastructure, physical or digital, whatever it is. And of course, that is where I suppose this foreign direct investment or even institutional investment can help. When we are able to show them good projects and good tech assets. That is my feeling.
Yeah, I mean, I just want to add to that is that generally the 3G technology that came to India was almost a failure because it did not provide the kind of quality service it should have. Even in 4G, most people would complain that they're not getting very good with this signal. But so that is where I wanted that if your paper can stress what is the kind of internet quality that India should target rather than what is there abroad. Okay. That would be very good value addition to the paper.
Yeah, let me intervene here and say it's work in progress.
Yeah.
Shankar will be writing a long paper for the fast shift. Okay.
Yeah.
And he would include a lot more suggestions and analysis and and also take some help from economists, I suppose, in the deeper questions you raised. And any more questions from the participants?
No, now we are waiting for you to speak.
Oh, okay. Yeah, the joker comes in the end in the circus. Let's get on to sharing screen. Yeah. And there it is. I'm sharing screen. And what is that? That is it. And there I... Aha. Okay. actually, as I told you, that to please my mocha as well as mecha, I have chosen this topic, simple constructive economic analysis of two optimization models. You know, I have a long name, Suresh Babu, Shyama Sundar Velagapudi. Dr. Parikh is the only one who remembers my whole name. And he kept joking whenever he met me, hey, what small name are you choosing in your current dispensation? Suresh or Babu or Shyama or Sundar? Well, that's the affectionate thing I had with him. And, you know, recently we exchanged an email in which I promised him that I would sprinkle some sufficient Sanskritam in the presentation because Dr. Parikh is a great scholar of Sanskritam. Though we never talked about in Indian Statistical Institute, we were always discussing America, you know. And so all my headings will be in Sanskritam and I'll give the translations too. Samskrita Bhasha Prayogam, that means a refinedish language experiment. Refinedish means Samskritam actually means refined in Samskritam. So the language I use is refinedish of 21st century, and that is general neutral California style. You know, California is the most ridiculed state in the most pitied country. I leave it to you, but let's have fun with Uber message. I got a message like this. Uber contractor Donald Trump arrived. They will wait for 5 minutes. If you do not show up for the ride in time, they will leave. Crystal clear. Okay, let us start the real one now. Kiritam Vande Irade Jagadgurum. That means let us salute the Irade founder, Guru Kiritam. You see, my association with him goes back to half a century. When I was a student at ISI, I read his 1970 EPW article and felt enthused. And I read it again. And the last sentence in that was this. It was a review article of a book, Economic Analysis and Input-Output Framework. And he says, read it. One comes to the sad conclusion that though Economic Analysis and Input-Output Framework, that's the title of the book, has lots of very useful input-output tables, it has very little economic analysis in it. That's sad indeed. Gurkir makes 3 points. Hey, that's an abbreviation because I find it tedious to, you know, do Guru Stuti, Guru Kiritam and all too much to say. So Gurkir also means, in my definition, sweet reasonableness. That's very characteristic of Dr. Parikh, even to this day. Old age didn't make him irritable. That's interesting, and that's remarkable too. Okay, the three important points he makes are, A, respect non-negativity restrictions. He's addressing to economists. R&R, that's important. Consider using linear optimization. The reason is linear optimization is well developed. Packages are available. He told us how in those Stone Age years, he struggled with those cards. Yes, he was, and you see, but packages are available even those days, 1970 we are talking. So, and then he makes an interesting point too about non-linearity. You know, that's where his sweet reasonables comes through. He says, a priori, my precedence is to accept your use of linear optimization, but non-linearities for these reasons, etc., etc. I urge you to read this paper again because it's very valuable. Okay. Now, to get on to the thing, what do we need? We need some Mlecha Ganitam Atmavalokanam. That is, Atma here stands for all the math adequate. And we do a bit of revision of that. And Dr. Singh enlightened us. We shouldn't get confused between identities and equations. Hey. Y is equal to mx plus c is identically equal to x is equal to y minus c divided by m, when of course m is not zero. If m is free, we know that division by zero is prohibited, right? And then that's it. Now, when you want to solve, then you get an equation. When you want to solve, that one you see is true for all x, as the logicians say. Universal quantifier for all x, that's what is the thing. Now, in mx plus c equal to zero, in this, we ask a question like, does there exist a real number that satisfies the equation? We should ask such questions. And it's easy to solve that by using that identity, right? But suppose if the equation is quadratic, x squared plus x plus one is equal to zero. There is no real number that satisfies the equation. There may be a complex number. Well, that's different. So what's the moral? We just cannot assume the existence. Needs a proof. Mocha will insist on that. Correct? Dr. Singh, that's to you. Guru Kiridam Suchanam Ansaraniyam. Gurkhir's suggestions are to be followed. I am giving you the translation for those who... Dr. Parekh, please take me to task if my translation is wrong. I don't think it is, but then anyway. Let's go on to the optimization models. These are based on a multi-plant firm that needs to minimize total cost. I actually worked for some such firm. There are two such problems. One is N plants with quadratic total costs and increasing marginal costs to meet a fixed demand D. The increasing marginal cost is the real thing here. That makes it amenable to marginal analysis. Notice in the first one, there are no capacity restrictions. In the second, there are capacity restrictions, or each plant has certain capacity. They can't produce beyond that. See what happens. In the first case, it's easy to get a feasible solution. Hey, any plant can produce any amount. Increasing, of course, marginal cost. So easy to get a feasible solution. Second case, infeasibility is a possibility because of the capacity restrictions. Again, existence question arises. Swalpa Bhashanam Guru Tirukko Guru Tiru Smrityartham. A few words in memory of Guru Tirukkodi Kaval and Srinivasan. Last meeting I had with him was on 5th April 2004 in his Yale University office. See, I wrote a paper for, that was an interesting meeting. It was only for 1.5 hours planned. And like the typical American tradition, I was about to walk out at 1.5 hours. He said, no, wait. I said, what, sir? Lunch. Oh, free lunch, I said. No free lunch. You earned it because you are the only person who recognized I was 60 in 1993 and wrote an article for me, which was published in Indian Economic Review. He actually read it. And that was on a new algorithm for a special quadratic programming model. So you earned it, come have lunch with me and then get out. I said, sir, okay. And then, okay, we spent the 1.5 hours with a lot of gossip about others, but about our respective papers too. He discussed that paper, my 1993 paper, for half an hour, and he insisted that I should discuss his 2003 paper, which was also published in Indian Economic Review. And that was fun too, but I won't go into details. Let's get back to our optimization models. If math is applicable, solution is by solving one equation in one variable, one linear equation, I should say. Mx plus c equal to zero type. What is math? Math is marginal equality theorem, much revered in among neoclassical economists. Incidentally, TNS also expands to tough neoclassical Srinivasan in the Yale faculty quarters. Anyway, what did I do in that paper? I said, hey, start with math. If it's not applicable, then you have an iterative process. That's what I suggested. Choosing an action on the plants, which plants are to close, which plants are to produce and not. And finally, depending on the overproduction or underproduction. And finally, I did manage to proof to the satisfaction of the referees. Then I raised an open question. Whether a finite algorithm exists if we approach from shadow price side. And my prejudice was that there was no finite algorithm if you come from shadow price side, not on the quantity side. I produced a finite algorithm with the quantity coming from quantity side. Okay, Guru Tiru Prashamsa. Guru Thiru praised my work. he remembered one particular paragraph I wrote there, and he asked me to read it out there. That is this: to take a sufficient condition, Mach incidentally is a sufficient condition, to take a sufficient condition and to reason about the problem as though that the condition is both necessary and sufficient is to opt for a heuristic approach to the problem. Theorists dislike such an approach, and practitioners justify it with the argument that it works most of the time. It is desirable to start from the practitioner's perception of economic reality and devise an algorithm whose end result satisfies the theorist. This makes the closed form solution corresponding to the principle of equality of marginal cost as the starting point of my algorithm. I suspect Professor Srinivasan learned to appreciate this type of thing because of his friendship with Dr. Kiret Parikh. Both, they were close friends when I was there in ISI. Gurudvayasneham Santoshakaranam, Santoshakaranam. Friendship of the two gurus is a cause of happiness for the graduate students hanging around. But Tien's article for KP 860 Festschrift describes existence questions as complex. I felt bad. Yet to Tien, Tien was a mathematician to start with. He got so thoroughly became an economist. He actually is a distinguished fellow of American Economic Association in 2003. And boorish Suresh Babu didn't even know that when he met Professor Srinivasan. But Professor Srinivasan was a modest guy. He didn't boast of it. He didn't tell me even. I came to know it later and felt foolish. I always felt foolish before TM. Anyway. Math mantram sarvatra siddham kutaha means math mantra does not work everywhere. Contrary to an assertion in an 1989 doctoral dissertation, where I quote, economic theory tells us optimal solution if and only if marginal costs are equalized. This made me sad because the mathematical formulation was full. Okay. With constraints and all, non-negativity restriction, ROR, which Gurkirn pointed to us, and then the capacity restrictions and so on. It didn't appear to be so to me. And I attributed it to the confusion of the author between sufficient and necessary conditions. And then the author goes on to do some wrong criticism of a 79D doctoral dissertation. And then they propose an epsilon optimality by bisection and claim that's the best. Well, well known and all. I didn't know. In fact, the first numerical analysis books I read, the first thing they say is bisection is bad. Use something else. Because bisection adds only one decimal where somewhere else, you know, it gets squared and all. We won't go detail into that. And there was, of course, a two-page treatise on Koresh Kuntakar conditions where what Dr. Singh mentioned, the confusion between identity and equity equation is very evident. And then the crowning glory of it was sensitivity analysis by a brute force method. All these things are sad, but let's not indulge in defects of others too much. Though I suspect gurus have a right. Tarkajnana vihina sishyanam garhaniyam. Disciples without knowledge of logic are to be censured. In 79 doctoral dissertation, implications of the capacity restrictions were not realized. I felt bad about that. And much inferior numerical algorithm for epsilon optimality was proposed. And some borrowed research limitations were not understood at all. Again, let us leave that. this is bad, but you know, as my friend, my Mocha and my Mecca both tell me, ingita jnana lopam vicharakaram, that is lack of common sense is sad. Yeah, I mean managerial economic common sense. Mecca will not tolerate me making mistakes in common sense. So I tried hard. I thought a lot about the common sense aspects of these problems, and I came to this conclusion. Dr. Parekh, please correct me if I am wrong in my common understanding of the situation. First one is unutilized plants have marginal costs greater than or equal to the shadow price. It makes sense, right? Because if it is less, it would produce. Yeah? We are trying to minimize costs and we are going the marginal way. And the marginal analysis is applicable here because of the increasing marginal costs. Suppose if it is decreasing average costs and economies of scale, all this gets knocked out. Yeah? All economists know convexity helps them. So many careers are sustained on that. Okay. The second one is underutilized plants have marginal costs equal to the shadow price. This is the celebrated myth, the gateway drug to neoclassical analysis, marginal equality theorem. And you will see now, fully utilized plants, that comes in only in the second model. Otherwise, only the first two would do. Fully utilized plants have marginal cost less than or equal to the shadow price. These three together form the optimality set of optimality conditions, which you can check your solution for. Hey, how do you get your solution? That may be your intuition, or practice, whatever. Guess and verify. You have to verify these three. If you do not verify, hey, you haven't got the optimal solution. Okay, this is just nothing but common sense, or actually interpretation of Kalish-Kuhn-Tucker conditions in this particular thing. Now you see the last three conditions, the first three conditions, you see we are coming from quantity side. A plant can be in only one of the three mutually exclusive states. It can either be unutilized, or it may be underutilized, or it may be fully utilized. There is no other way, correct? So it is mutually exclusive and collectively exhaustible, as Dr. Singh used this expression. That's it. But if you look at the other side, the relationship between the shadow price and the marginal cost, those are not mutually exclusive. Notice that. So let us come from the shadow price side and write this stuff. Logically equivalent set, which is first one, if MC is greater than shadow price, plant is a shadow price, plant is unutilized. Sure, correct? Why do you utilize the plant if the marginal cost is greater? You are trying to minimize the cost, right? Total cost. If MC is equal to the shadow price, the plant state is undetermined. This is what makes meth inapplicable in certain situations. Math is sufficient. If you get it, that's fine. But if you don't, then there is a problem. That, notice that. No, it will be lovely if we have symmetry all the time, you know, all these mathematicians and all who get go eloquent about symmetry. Well, in real life, it doesn't happen, as you see. If you insist on mutual exclusivity in the relationship between marginal cost and shadow price, you don't get the other side. And these three are logically derivable from those. This is all done, and you know, this will be part of the 10-page printed paper for the fresh shrift of Dr. Parekh. And then, well, if you get confused between this, you can make thousands of mistakes. Many mistakes are possible, but let us not go into the mistakes. Let us be constructive now. We said till now it's all simple, but Arthika Sandhana Nirmanam is important. Economic solution construction. How do we do that? We just sort plants by marginal cost at both limits. Beginning of production and at full capacity. What is marginal cost? Hey, I forgot. In the Atma, we need to know a bit about derivatives too, because after all, marginal cost is nothing but the derivative of the total cost function, as we say in the first year undergrad economics class or math class or whatever. Okay. We do that. We sort, we have a list of all the N plants, the list containing N. We sort plants by marginal cost at both limits. And then we calculate the production corresponding to the numbers. That's easy. We know that. That's where, you know, I gave a formula in my 93 paper, and as the same for the formula appears in 7DD, 8DD. I mean, 7DD stands for 79 doctoral dissertation. 8DD 2. That's so we can calculate the production corresponding to the numbers. We do that. We build up that list and we will travel along the list as nice. And then we will find the last case will be where demand is between underproduction and overproduction. At a certain place, it will be underproduction and there will be overproduction. Then all that we have to do is, you know, go back to our Atma. Solve a linear equation in one variable. One equation in one variable is simple to solve, Dr. Singh assures me. And Dr. Singh insisted that I should show at least one diagram. Otherwise, the presentation is not complete. And here is the diagram. Okay, on y-axis you have the production. On this you have shadow prices. They're coming from the dual. Shadow price is a very unfortunate term. Dr. Parikh mentioned it in his book with Eckhaus on the planning in India. But then it stuck, that is the jargon of the economists. So these are the shadow prices. And you can see this breakpoint, that's where, you know. Here it is, you see, underproduction. Here it is overproduction. And corresponding to this, this is that demand which we wanted to meet. And corresponding to that, we found out the shadow price by just linear interpolation. What else can be simpler than this? This is simple ranking algorithm. Incidentally, if you remember, Dr. Parikh's suggestion, CLO, consider linear optimization. Instead of quadratic cost, suppose we have linear cost. What would happen? That is the ranking algorithm we do, and we are all familiar with it. I started all my algorithm design classes with for software engineers with that linear cost thing. Okay, and that concept, now I extended it to quadratic cost. Yeah. I succeeded, and this is the newer algorithm, okay? I came up with, yeah, but let me rant for just a minute. I have about samvada nirlakshyam guruvecha vruttidroham. Neglecting to discuss technical points is a betrayal of guru and the profession of economics. 7DD, I talked to the person, and the person said, international authorities approved my thesis, so who are you? You must be wrong. I said, well, Gurudroham. And 8DD went a step further and said, who are you? You are not an economist. You have a PhD in computer science. How can you speak about economics? And international authorities approved again. Well, crooks exist. In my childhood, my South Asian cultural heritage, I'm very proud of. I heard in my childhood this particular thing. Ativinayam dhurta lakshanam. Too much obedience to international or national authorities is characteristic of crooks. Sorry, can't help laughing. Hey, though we started with a little sadness, let us celebrate first computing comrade in Delhi. I was doing computing in IIT Madras. Shankar described the whole horrible state IIT Madras was in those days. Of course, with in Delhi, with IBM 1620 and Planning Commission, and with computing comrade Kirit Parekh, it was great. And he was an inspiration for a quality research work for the whole half a century. So 2 KB at 85 with a joy and a newer algorithm, which I came up with. Thank you very much, and you can ask questions now. Anyone?
I have an observation.
Yes, please.
I would say that for a guru, the best aspiration is shishyat ipset parajayam, right?
That's interesting, sir.
So I think we always like our students to excel us. Yeah. And I think it was nice to listen to this and your description of this. Such a simple way of doing things, but you have explained it clearly and shown in your last thing how you can solve fairly complex problems in a simple way. And that, I think, is the sign of creativity and clear understanding of the problem. Thank you, Suresh. One could say, as we used to call, VKRV Rao was known as four-letter Rao. Have you been christened as a four-letter Velugopati? Well, anyway, all the best to you. And thank you very much. Right.
Any other comments, questions? Dr. Singh.
Yes.
You will have the opportunity to peer review my 10-page paper for the first shift.
Yes. I think it's pretty good. When you write it up, I will certainly have a look at it.
Thank you. And my Mecca, Shankar, yeah. Does it make sense, common sense wise and production management wise a little?
Yeah, sure.
I always try to balance my exposition between the two of you.
That makes it more practical also.
Yeah. Any suggestions for making the exposition better?
I think the explanation, I mean, what you have said is definitely logical, but suppose if a person who is not so informed about optimization has to start. So I think it would be a good idea to explain it with a, you know, example of a certain firm, you know, how, you know, some data.
The idea is,
like it's an textbook.
Yeah, it's,
that would be a very good term.
For reality, Prabal, because
yeah.
This is just to show how a little economic analysis. Dr. Parekh hit at economists saying very little economic analysis. And I just wanted to show off as an economist trained by Dr. Parekh and Guru Tiru, you know, a little economic analysis solves the problem. And we don't need to be dazzled by the math maya or comp pomp comes where people throw packages at you and try to dazzle you. And math maya comes when mathematicians take over economics and talk of Banach spaces and finishes off. You know, And that I tried to be an undergrad economist, you know, to solve, to think. This is to think in a common sense way. But then, as they say, science is sophisticated common sense. So it's all there, you know. In fact, if you remember when you asked me what my title was, I thought I would say Karish Kuntakar Theorem and Economists. But I didn't want to go that way because that would start with math. That would be, of course, it's good and all, but, you know, but all these things will come out in the in the printed paper, you know, it'll be 10. And I can send you my 1993 paper to anyone. It's available now on Gestor. And I should tell you a little story about the publication of that. I met the editor and he said, hey, you are an engineer. How could your referees accepted this paper without a single comment, single adverse comment, he meant. How is that? This can't be. In my journal, every author goes through 2 or 3 revisions, he said. I said, sir, I was trained in economics by Guru Thiru and Guru Kiri. So I can also do economics if I choose to do. If I have chosen to do other things to make money is a separate matter. Where will the knowledge go? The knowledge will not go anywhere. But he said, there is one mistake. TN is not 60 yet. I have met him only last month. He looked, say, 55. I said, that's great. But I have documentary evidence to produce for you. Because I am a public sector bureaucrat. Bureaucrats live on documentary evidence. So here is a thing which says, Professor Srinivasan completes 60 years in 1993. Then, of course, Panditji was very, very nice, laughed it off, and then said goodbye. Okay, I think that ends. That story is interesting. To end, we exceeded, and you people all have to go and have your dinner, and I need to have my breakfast.
Yeah, sure.
Anything else? Yeah. Joker promised entertainment and delivered on entertainment. What do you say, Dr. Farik?
One last comment I have. Have you extended this to a case where there are multiple plants and multiple demand points?
I will try so.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. From the kind of work we do, I think the application of this to, say, electricity sector, or say transport sector would be very interesting. Maybe not transport, electricity, if you can. So that was the example I was talking of. Illustrating with an example would be very good. So that's fine.
Yeah, okay. We interact a lot more. Yes.
Yeah.
I am all for. This is to celebrate Dr. Parikh's 885. Yeah, this will be
thank
an
you
interesting
very much.
Paper.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you,
sir.
Yeah. Thank you.
And good night, all. Thank you all for attending. Right.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. See you. Bye-bye. Good night.